Today we're going to learn Daf Shabbat Kuf Mem Chet. Today's shiur is sponsored by Julie Mendelson in honor of her son Noah, who's drafting into the Army on Sunday. In her words, my favorite study partner, I know you might not have time to listen to the Daf every day, but we'll all learn on your behalf while you defend us. Bezrat Hashem, I hope you have a successful and meaningful service and come home safe and sound. Love, Mom. Much hatzlacha to you, Noah. We're going to start now at the very bottom. Ein machzirin et hashever. This the Mishnah had said, you can't fix a break if you break a bone on Shabbat. Amar Rav Chana Bagdata, Amar Shmuel. He said in the name of Shmuel, this is Rav Chanan from Baghdad, said to in the name of Shmuel, halacha machzirin et hashever. Seems he must have had a different version of the Mishnah, and in his version it said, you can fix a break on Shabbat. Rabba Bar Bar Chana ikla lepumbedita. Okay, Rabba Bar Bar Chana comes to Pumbedita. Pumbedita was where Rav Yehuda was the Rosh Hashiva. He was a student of Rav and Shmuel. Rav set up the Beit Midrash, his Beit Midrash in Sura, and Shmuel had his Beit Midrash, his yeshiva in Nehardea, and Rav Yehuda sets up his yeshiva in Pumbedita. He establishes the yeshiva in Pumbedita. So Rabba Bar Bar Chana gets there, lo ala pirkei de Rav Yehuda. He doesn't come into the shiur. Shadre la Ada Dayala. So Rabbi Yehuda sends to Ada his servant, or someone who is one of his workers, and says, Amale Zil Garbie. So he says, go grab him. Okay, some people say it means grab him, some people say take something away from him so to ensure that he actually comes to the Beit Midrash. Ata Eshkache de Kadarish. Ein machzirin et hashever. So when Rabbi Bar Bar Chana comes into the Beit Midrash, he hears Rabbi Yehuda saying, you can't fix a break. So Rabbi Bar Bar Chana says to him, Hachi Amar Rav Chana Bagdata, Amar Shmuel. But doesn't Rav Chana Bagdata say in the name of Shmuel, Halacha Machzirin Et Hashever? Now what's interesting about this is, as I said, Rabbi Yehuda was a student of Shmuel. And more so than that, so you should have known this, and all the more so, Rabbi Bar Bar Chana is someone who comes from Israel. And what's he doing knowing what goes on in Bavel? So here comes Rav Yehuda's response. And he says, Baha Shmuel Didan. Shmuel is one of us. Oh, sorry, I skipped. Amalei, ha chana didan. Ha Shmuel didan. Chana Bagdata, he's one of ours. And Shmuel, he's one of ours, meaning they're from here. Even though Chana Bagdata was from Baghdad, but he must have been called that because maybe his family was from there, but he was now living in Bavel. Velo Shmuelei. And I never heard this before. Pila bedina garavtich. Isn't it good that I forced you to come to the Beit Midrash? Okay, either right, by pushing you or by, you know, grabbing you or by taking some collateral from you in order to insist that you come. Misha nifraka yado. Okay, someone, now the next halacha in the Mishnah is if your hand comes out of its place, lo yitrafein betzonein, one of the things they would do was to pour cold water on it and kind of mix it up in cold water. You can't do that, but rochetsu kidarko, and if it works, it works. Great. Rav Avia, but really you're not allowed to do this on Shabbat. Rav Avi have a yativ kamei de Rav Yosef. Shanya le yade. So something happened to his hand. And Amar le hachimai. He says, can I do the following? So asur. He says, no, you can't. Vahachimai. He keeps suggesting different possibilities of things he could do to fix it. Amar le asur. Adahachi itpach yade. In the meantime, his hand gets cured on its own. Amar le. So Rav Yosef says to him, maiti ba'elach. Why are you bothering me about this in the first place? Hatnan, it says explicitly in the Mishnah, Misha nifraka yado raglo lo yitrapein betzonein. Aval rochetz kedarkovi nitrapein nitrapei. So why are you asking me? It's very clear from the Mishnah that there's nothing you're allowed to do about this. So Amar Lei, he says to him, V'lo tznan, em machzirin et hashever, v'amar Rav Chana Bagdata, Amar Shmuel, halacha machzirin et hashever. But didn't it say in the previous line in the Mishnah that you can't put back the break? You can't reset the hand. But Rav Chana Bagdata said in the name of Shmuel that the halacha is that we do, and he had a different version. So if he had a different version of that, can't we just assume that maybe what it says in the Mishnah that's in front of us isn't true about the next part also, about the part about Nifraka Yado Lo Yitrafein Betzonein? So Amalei, Kulu Bechada Machita Machitnu, what, you're putting everything into all the same place? Hecha De Itmar Itmar, Hecha De Lo Itmar Lo Itmar. What's said about Rav Chana Bagdata, said in the name of Shmuel, is about one line, not about the other line. You can't clump everything together and say just because he had a different version about that line, it means he necessarily had a different version about everything else. No, I don't know why you're saying that. And basically, even though this line was changed, the other line was not changed. And therefore, I don't even know why you were asking me this question. Hadron ala chavit, and with that we move to a new perek. By the way, I made up a sheet today which kind of organizes the structure of what goes on in the page, and I brought a few extra things and extra sources here and there. So if you want to follow on the sheet, you can find it on the website on Hadran for today's stuff. Shoel adam lechaberot kadei yayin bekadei shemen. Okay, the background you need to know is that masa umatan, any kind of business, is forbidden on Shabbat. So now the question is, what constitutes a business deal? What doesn't constitute a business deal? We generally learn it's forbidden from the pasuk, im tashim b'shabbat raglecha, me'asot chafatzecha. Remember, chafatzecha is what you generally do, right? V'daber davar, and different hiluch b'shabbat, and all that. And they learn from there that business dealings are also forbidden. That's something you normally do during the week. You don't do it on Shabbat. However, you can borrow wine and oil on Shabbat. Now, what does it mean to borrow? To borrow really means that they're loaning it to you and you're returning it, right? Because you're not going to return the exact item. You're going to return. You're going to drink it. It's not like something that you borrow and give back. No, you're borrowing it to use and then you're going to return it after. So it's kind of like a loan. So they say you can do this, but it has to be very done in a specific manner. You can't say, loan it to me. You can say, I want to borrow, but you can't use the wording of loaning. We'll get to the Gemara, we're going to see what's the difference. A woman can borrow from a friend, kikarot, bread. Again, she's going to end up eating it and giving her back other bread. And if you're worried that the person that you loan to is not, that you lent to, is not going to give it back. You can make him leave a collateral, something, an object for collateral, and you can go back after Shabbat and do a cheshbon with him, right? Get your money back. Another thing you could do, if Erev Pesach comes out on Shabbat, and you're in Yerushalayim, and you need to get meat. So, miniach talito etzlo, v'notelet pischo, v'osei mo cheshbon l'achar yom tov. You can buy your animal, and, right, what do? You take it from someone. You don't buy it. You take it from someone, and you say, oh, I'll deal with paying you after Yom Tov. Okay, so you're allowed to do this for the Korban Pesach. So comes the Gemara and says, Amar le Rav bar Rav Hanan la Abaye. Maishna shileni umaishna haveni. What's the difference? Amar le. So Abaye answers him, Hashileni lo ati lemichtav. One of the reasons why you can't do Masa Umatan is that we're worried that you're going to write down. Besides what I said before about it's a general thing you do on the weekday, but also you might write things down. So here we say, if you say, I'm lending you, or can you lend me, then they're not going to write it down. Halveni ati lemichtav. But if you say, I'm going to lend you, then, or loan me, please, then there's a good chance they're going to write it down. Why? It's not so clear still. So Rashi has one explanation, the Ri has another explanation. I brought it on the sheet. You can look inside. Rashi says that generally, when you say, I'm going to borrow, you're going to return it in a very short amount of time, and therefore you don't write it down. But generally, you get to my age, you start to forget things already. So if I don't write it down, I'm not going to remember it. But if it's in the course of just a few days, I'll probably remember. But a month from now, forget about it. So that's the difference between Halveni and Hashileni, according to Rashi. The Ri says, Hashileni, generally, you're going to return the actual item. Whereas Halveni, usually you want to lend someone money and they usually spend the money and they return different money. Now, this case happens to be that you're clearly not going to return the same item. But because you're using the wording of loaning, and loaning generally is something that you're going to return as it is, therefore borrowing usually means I'm going to borrow it and I'm going to return it. So therefore, borrowing is a lashon that we're going to allow. We're not really worried that you're going to come to right. Okay, so now the Gemara says, okay, since on a regular day, normally, you might say halveni, va'armale hashileni. In other words, we're now going to say, what do you mean? Sometimes people say halveni, sometimes they say hashileni, and they use those words interchangeably on a weekday. In other words, and since they use them interchangeably, it's very possible that somebody might say borrow and somebody might write it down. So b'shabbat nami ati lemichtav. So what do they answer? Amale, I'm going to skip the parentheses right now. B'shabbat kevan dehashileni hu desharu le'rabanan halveni lo sharu le minkra miltav lo ati lemichtav. Everybody knows, now this assumes people all know halacha, that hashileni is the wording you're allowed to use. Therefore, they're going to know that it's different. And because of that, they're not going to come to right. It's going to remind them that this is the situation. Before we go on, I want to just go back to one thing that I forgot to read, which is I brought this source about the women and the bread. Okay, the question is, why does the Mishnah specifically say V'chein ha'isha mechaverta ki karot? Okay, so why does it specifically say? So the Ritva has two interesting explanations. He says, and this comes to teach you. In other words, women, don't think women, oh yeah, they're nice, they give away everything. No, no, no. The women in their day, at least according to him, right, were very careful about what about lending things. And they were very careful, just like men. Okay, you might have thought that even hashileni would be a problem. And therefore, it needs to tell you, no, you can do it. Second option, inami hakamashwan. It's just interesting because the Ritva is trying to think about why specifically women and what makes women different. So here it's interesting. They're saying they're super careful. They don't give out anything without making sure they get it back. Inami hakamashwan. Afagav denashim lo regile lemichtav tasur lehem lamarhaveni. Maybe it's telling you the opposite according to his second interpretation. Women are more likely for you to think you could salveni one woman to another because women generally didn't write in those days. And because they didn't write, so the whole concern that you might come to write is only relevant for men and not for women. Here they're coming to teach you, no, no, no. Even women, there's still a concern that they may write. Okay, so two interesting things about women. Either they're very careful and they when they loan out their stuff, or that they might come to, that they are likely not going to really write, but yet we're going to say it anyway. Okay, moving on. We're now four lines from the bottom of Kuf Mem Chen Amud Aleph. Amar Le Rava Bar Rav Chanan La Abaye. Michti Amru Rabbanan Kol Milei De Yom Tov Kama De Efshar L'Shenuyei Mashnina. Since we say that when it comes to anything we allow you to do on Yom Tov, the assumption here is we probably mean any. Some most. This is a bit of a different of opinion, but let's just assume anything we allow for Ochal Nefesh for Yom Tov, we still want you to do it if possible in a different way than you do it on a regular day. So Hane Nashe Damalian Chatzbay Umaya, my time alone Mashanina. Why would the women fill up their water from the well? Why do we allow this? Now, this is one of the things they need their water for Shabbat. And also, the other issue is there's no problem of Hotza'ah on Yom Tov. You can carry on Yom Tov. So why, when they fill up their water and carry it home, do we not make them do it with any sort of change? It's why some of the Mefreshim explained that what we mean is when we allow carrying on Yom Tov, we only allow it with a shinoi, with some sort of change. So the answer is mishum delo efsha, because they have no other way to change. Why? Well, how would you change? Hechilavde, demalian b'chatz, but how could they do it some other way? Hecha la'avde, demalian b'chatz b'rabba. Maybe they could do it in many, right? Demalian b'chatz b'rabba, limlu b'chatz zuta. So they say, let's say you usually carry in a big jug, so carry it in a small jug. Or a big basket and a small basket. So they say, but we don't want to make them do that because we're going to make them walk many more times. If we move it into something smaller, they'll have to carry many more times. We don't want them to work harder on Yom Tov. Tamayim b'chatz b'zuta, if they carry from a big jug, limlu b'chatz b'rabba. So let's make them carry in a large jug, but we don't want to make them do that because kamafshu b'masui. We're going to make them carry a much heavier burden. We certainly don't want that. Nifros sudra, maybe we make them cover the jug. No, but then it might get wet and then you might come to squeeze it and that's a problem. Maybe we'll make you cover it with a wax, right? What is this? A wooden cover. But that is tied on the wooden cover. So if it's tied on with the wooden cover's tied on, it might untie, and then she'll come to tie it again, and that's is malacha. So basically, any shinoi we're going to try to do is only going to make it worse as it comes to Yom Tov, either more work, or she might actually come to do something forbidden, like srita, squeezing, or like tying. So therefore, hilkach lo efshar, and that's why they don't do it with any sort of change. For Amale Rava Bar Rav Hanan la'abaye. Rava Bar Hanan says, Tabaye tanan. It says in the Mishnah, Lo misapkin velo mitapkin velo miragdim biyom tov. Okay, this is a Mishnah in Shabbat. It's not in Shabbat. It's a Mishnah in Beitza. And it says, you can't clap and you can't tap your hands on your legs and you can't dance, although some people say mitapkin is something else. Anyway, you can't dance on Yom Tov. And we see people are doing this. So first of all, why can't you do all these things? So the most of the Mefarshim say that the reason for all these things is that, right, Rashi adds this thing that clapping is mishum avil, and we don't want people to do something that they would do for avilut on chag. But generally, most people think that all of these things are what Rashi says on merakdin, l'simcha, v'tam ha'mefarsh b'masecha beitza, shema yitaken kli shiur. We're worried that you're going to fix your musical instrument. You might tune it, right? You're going to come to sing. If you sing, you might come to play musical instruments. Musical instruments are forbidden because you might come to fix them. And therefore, we don't want to allow you to fix them. And that's why we don't allow you to do any of these things. Some people say nowadays, I think it's in the, forget where it's quoted, Mishnah Berurah, Rama. I think the Rama says it, that nowadays nobody fixes, you're not going to come to fix an instrument and therefore it's allowed. We all know that people sit at the table. There are many people who do clap or bang on the table when they're singing Zmirot. Some people don't. There's different customs about it. But some there are sources that say that this is possibly no longer relevant. So now, well, or the question is maybe it's for this reason. Okay, now we're going to see. This is probably one of the reasons why this developed in the following way is that people are actually doing it because look what happened. They say, but people are doing this and nobody says anything to them. Meaning the rabbis don't stop them. So then they say, according to your question, remember we just learned this the other day. Don't sit in the mavoi, in the alleyway, right at the entrance next to the lechi, because the lechi is meant to be a sign that you shouldn't go past here. And yet you're not going to see it while you're sitting next to it. And you might see something and go bring it from the public domain to the private or to the mavoi, to the alley. And therefore, and Rava forbade this. We see that people put down their jugs right there and they sit at the entrance to the mavoi. And nobody stops them. So he's going to now, he kind of counters him with another question and says, well, look, this also nobody is doing. Ela Hanach L'Yisrael, famous line, and we learned this already earlier in the Masechet. I'm not going to go in depth about it, but you can go back to where we learned it. We came up with the jewelry on Shabbat, women wearing jewelry. It was the same thing. You're not allowed to go out if there's no Eruv with jewelry, and yet women do it. So the answer given here is the same one is given there. Mutav Shu Shogim V'al Yehu Mezidin. We'd rather not tell people because we know that people are going to do this anyway. They're not going to listen. So better that they do it b'shogeg than do it b'mezi. Better they be unwitting about it than know what they're doing and yet do it anyway. So now comes the Gemara and the Gemara says, Savonina. We assume, now if you look at all these things, not to clap, not to stand at the entrance of the mavoi, not to wear jewelry, all those things are isurim de rabbanan, rabbinic prohibitions so that you don't come to do something else. So they assumed, like you probably would have assumed, which is hanimile b'derabanan, aval b'doraita lo. You would have thought this is only in derabanans where we say this. In other words, again, let's figure out the situation. People are doing this anyway. Now, what's the issue? The concern is if they do this, we're worried they might come to do something else. But if we tell them they can't do this, then they're going to be blatantly not doing it. And we don't even know if they're going to necessarily do the d'oraita that we're worried that they're going to do. So it makes sense to say in those cases, let's just leave them and let them do it. But if it's an isra d'oraita that people are doing, no way are we going to let them do it. But velohi, people thought that. Remember, every time it says savor mina, we're going to reject that. But in fact, it's not the case. Lo shna b'derabana velo shna b'doraita. It's also true for Do'oraitas. How do we know this? Deha tosefet yom kippurim Do'oraitahi. Adding on time to Yom Kippurim, generally when we bring in Shabbat, we bring in Shabbat earlier than we're supposed to and we end it later than we're supposed to. We add a few minutes here and there. If you just noticed the fast of Tisha B'Av was yesterday, it ended earlier 2 days ago, depending on when you're listening to this. For me, it's still Friday. And it ended earlier than Shabbat generally ends. That's because we don't have a halacha of Tosefet Tisha B'Av, but we do have a halacha of Tosefet Yom Kippurim. Now Shabbat, it's not such a big deal for people to keep an extra few minutes, but Yom Kippurim, they're all starving, so they want to eat. So what happened? Tosefet Yom Kippurim Do'oraita. Now it's not 100% Do'oraita. It's learned out from the Torah. And some of us should basically say, based on this, we don't mean actual things that are said explicitly in the Torah, but things that are derived from the Torah, as opposed to the other category of things where they were all just rabbinic prohibitions so that you don't come to transgress something it says in the Torah. But this is actually derived from the Torah itself, because it says, right, they learn from there. There's an issue of Tosefet. Also, right, Yom HaTshi'i and Yom HaSiri, it mentions the ninth day. Also, anyway, they learn from there that there's Tosefet. I don't remember exactly the drasha right now, but it's from there. We'll come across it again. Anyway, Tosefet to Yom HaKippurim Do'oraita hi. Okay, it's a halacha mi Do'oraita. And Bekachazina lehu deka'achle v'shatu ad shetechshach. This is even actually before Yom Kippur, that they eat until it gets dark and nobody stops them. Okay? Nobody prevents them from doing this. Okay, what it means, I assume they don't mean Seder Kochavim, but I assume they mean that they don't add extra time before. And basically, here we see people are doing this and nobody's stopping them. So here it seems that B'Do'oraita, we would also say the following thing. Okay, which is very interesting in terms of, as I said, right? The question is this really D'Oraita or is it kind of D'Oraita? Okay, moving on. Okay, how did we get to this, by the way? This is an aside, okay? And you can see this on the sheet also. Rabba Bar Rav Hanan said to Abaye, okay? He said to Abaye, what's the difference between Hashileni and what's the difference between Halveni? Okay? Then Rabba Bar Rav Hanan said to Abaye, what about Komilei Diyom Tov De'Afshar L'Shanuyei Mashaninan? Again, totally different topic, but it was the same person asking the question to Abaye. And then again, he asks again about Lo Mesapkin v'lo Metapkin v'lo Merakdin, and why do people do it? And then he gets answered, Mutav Shu Shogegin v'Aryu Mezidin. Okay, the Ritva, just as an aside, I'm just going to bring the Ritva again today. He says, the Ritva says, the reason why Mutav Shu Shogegin v'Aryu Mezidin is because people are used to things and it's very hard to get people to change from things they're used to. It's an interesting approach that just because people are used to something, we don't make them change. Anyway, it's just one of the reasons given for why we say better they should be shogin volume is eating. Okay, moving on. Chin ishami chavarta ki karo, right? They can borrow loaves of bread from their friends. B'Shabbat hu da'asur, aval b'chol shapir dami, right? This seems to say, right? Remember, ishami chavarta ki karot, she can say hashileni, but not halveni. What does this say, though? It seems clear that during the week, you could even say halveni. Now, why would you think there would even be an issue? Well, we're going to see right now. Lema matnitin de lo ki hilel. Why don't we say that our Mishnah doesn't seem to follow hilel? It's not. It says in the following Mishnah, the Mishnah in Mesachet Shvi'it, about Shnat Shemitah, v'chein haya hilel omer, lo telave isha ki kar l'chaverta, ad sh'tehasena damim, shema yukru chitim v'nimtzu ba'ot lidei ribit. Here we have a problem with rebate. What's the problem with rebate? Rebate is interest. You're not allowed to loan someone on interest. So if I loan you something and you pay me back more, then I have basically loaned to you on interest and you've borrowed on interest. So what's the problem? I can't loan you bread unless we say this bread is worth X amount of money. Because what if next week or in 2 weeks or 3 weeks when you go to return me the bread went up in value. So when you return me the same piece of bread, same, let's say, size loaf of bread, you're actually returning me something that's valued at more than what I lent you. That's interest. So therefore, we have to set a price and say, I'm returning to you 10 shekels worth of bread. And then when you return it, right, I'm loaning you 10 shekels worth of bread. When you return it, you return me 10 shekels worth of bread, whatever the price happens to be then. But otherwise, no. So now they're assuming, right, Hillel said that you can only do it if you set a price. And our Mishnah didn't say anything about setting a price. So it seems like our Mishnah must not hold like Hillel, because it seems like during the week, you can loan anytime, you can loan bread without a problem. So now the Gemara says, no, afilu tema hilel, haba atra de kitz tamea, haba atra de lo kitz tamea. There's some places where they keep the price of bread stable, where the price of bread is the same across the board, right? It's like in Israel, for example, milk is always the same price wherever you buy it. There's certain things that their prices are controlled. So if the price of bread is controlled and it's the same price everywhere, then I can lend it to you. Why? Because then even if we don't set a price, we all know that the price of bread today is 10 shekels. So if you go return me in a month from now and the price of bread goes up, then you're only going to return me 10 shekels worth, because it's easy to evaluate what the bread was on that day, because everybody, it's all the same price everywhere. But if the price of bread is different in my store and your store and, you know, all around, or my bread that I sell, you know, if all the prices are different, then we have to be very clear about a price. Otherwise, it's going to be impossible for them to return you the proper amount. And if they don't, there'll be a problem of interest. And then we'd have to say again, Hillel is talking in a place where, when he said you have to set a price, it's a place where low-key step, where there's no set price. And our Mishnah was talking about a place where there is a set price, and that's why that wasn't a factor, because it was obvious that what the price was. So now we say, if they don't believe you, then what do? We say, if you don't trust the person who borrows, then you can insist that they leave some piece of clothing or something as collateral, even on Shabbat. Itma. So now there's a machlok. Halva'at Yom Tov. What happens if you loan money on Yom Tov? Rav Yosef Amar lo nitna li tava. You can't demand that in court. If you lend someone something on Yom Tov, let's say I gave you my bread and you didn't return it to me, can't take you to court on it because it's not a real loan. Ve'rava Amar nitna li tava. Oh yeah, absolutely you can. Oh, I forgot to mention some important point. Okay, the important point I forgot to mention, which I actually remembered to put on the sheet, but I forgot to mention it here, is that the Mishnah specifically talks about yayin, shemen, wine, oil, and bread. These are things that one needs for Shabbat or for Yom Tov, if it's Yom Tov. So now the issue is that we only allow you to loan out items that one needs for Shabbat or for Yom Tov, because it's necessary. The person needs it. They won't have food otherwise. That's why we allow it. So now, here comes the machloka between them. Why do Rabba and Rav Yosef disagree about whether or not you can collect this loan in court? Rav Yosef Amar lo nitna li tava, you can't collect it in court. Why is that? Di amart nitna li tava, if you said you can collect it in court, ata the michta, they're going to come to write it. And that was the whole reason we didn't allow. Rabba, because how else are you going to demand something in court if you have nothing in writing? Rabba Amar nitna li tava, no, you can demand it in court. Why? Diamar lo nitna li tava, lo yavle, vata b'mnuyam, simchat yom tov. If we don't allow you to lend it to the person, right? If you can't get it back in court, well, then no one ever is going to lend it on Shabbat. And therefore, right, unless they're super nice and don't really care, but generally, people are going to want to make sure that they can get it back. And therefore, we're going to prevent people from simchat yom tov. And that's why we allow you to be able to demand it back in court, even though technically it's not really a loan. Tnan. Now we're going to say, we're now going to try to bring a proof for Rabba's position. So Iyamar, remember, you can leave your talit. Iyamar bishlama lo nitna li tava, mishum hachi miniach talito etzlo. So if you say, it's not nitna, sorry, this is a proof for Rav Yosef, my mistake. Seems to be a proof for Rav Yosef. If you say, lo nitna li tava, which was what Rav Yosef said, that's why miniach talito etzlo. Vosei mochashbol nachar Shabbat. Ela, Iyamart, nitna li tava, amai miniach talito etzlo. In other words, why would you need to take your, if you can go to court, you don't even need him to leave your talit. You can just demand from, you know, you could just go to court. So Amar, lo bi'ina delekum bedina v'dayina. I don't want to have to bother. Yes, it's true I can go to court, Rabbi says. It's true I could go to court, but I'd rather not go to court if I could avoid it. And therefore, that's why we're allowed to take the collateral. Mativ Rav Idi Bar Avin. Okay, Rav Idi Bar Avin now comes to say, "Hashochetet hapara b'chelka b'rosh Hashana, im haya chadash chodesh meubar mishamet v'im lav eno mishamet." Okay, we have an interesting case here. We're right at the end of the Shemitah year. We're sitting on Rosh Hashanah of the new year. Now, if the loan is done on the previous year, then what happens at the end of the Shemitah? The loan is canceled. So, if you take a loan on the last day of the year, the loan is canceled. You take a loan on the beginning, the first day of the new year, well, then the loan's not canceled because it's already not the Shemitah year. So if you slaughter a para and chilka b'Rosh Hashanah, and you gave it out on Rosh Hashanah, right here, I assume we mean chilka, you lent it to someone on Rosh Hashanah. I'm not sure why they use the word chilka. I'm just going to look in Rashi for a minute. Ah, right. That's what it is. You gave it out to buyers on Rosh Hashanah, but you're the butcher. You slaughtered your animals on the morning of Rosh Hashanah or the night before, and you give it out to people on Rosh Hashanah, assuming they're going to pay you back after the Chag. So, imaya chodesh meubar mishamet. If it turned out that Elul was a full month, then what happens? The first day of Rosh Hashanah ended up being the 30th day of Elul, really. That means the Chodesh Mu'bar had 30 days. And then it's going to basically, the loan is going to be canceled. No one has to pay him back. But if not, if it was actually Rosh Hashanah already, then it's not canceled. Now, what does this have to do with us? Well, if you say, like Rav Yosef tried to say, then why is the loan canceled? Because if it's not really a loan, right? Because if you can't demand it in court, then it's not even a loan. If it's not a loan, then it doesn't come in the category of loans that are canceled out. So what did they answer? No. What do you mean? It was something, why do we say is if it was done on Yom Tov. This turns out, retroactively, it turned out this day wasn't even Yom Tov, which was, done on a regular day, and then it, in fact, is a loan. And that's why. Okay, that's how Rav Yosef explains it according to his approach. Okay, another attempt to try to bring a proof against Rav Yosef. Tashma mi seifa. Look at the last part there. Im lav, if it actually comes out on Rosh Hashanah itself, eino mishamet, it's not canceled. So iamar bishlama nitznali tava, if you say like Rabbi, you can bring it in court, hainu dekatani eino mishamet. Again, the wording, eino mishamet, is wording used for a loan. Eli iamar lo nitznali tava, eino mishamet. Right? What does it mean, eino mishamet, if it's not even a loan? So, right, again, according to Rav Yosef, you can't bring it in court, there, you can't demand it in court, therefore it's not a loan. So what does it mean? Di'yayv le shakim. It means that if he gives it back to him, he's allowed to take it. That's what it means, eino mishamet. It means that if the person, if those people pay him the money after, he doesn't have to return it to them, he can take it. So now they're going to say, wait a minute. That's meaning, eino mishamet means the loan's not canceled, which means you can actually collect the money, right? You might have thought, maybe it isn't. So now they're going to say, wait a minute. Are you trying to say when it said eino mishamet, it means the loan's not canceled. You can, if they give you the money, you can keep it. That means if the loan is canceled and yet they try to pay you the money, you have to give it back to them. So what do they say? Well, what it means is reisha tzarich lemeimar le mishametani. Seifa lo tzarich lemeimar le mishametani. If it happened, it was still in the Shemitah year and they try to give you back the money and you have to say to them, I'm canceling this loan. If they decide to give it to you anyway, you're allowed to keep it. But if it's no longer the Shemitah year, because it happened in Rosh Hashanah, then you don't have to say the words, Mishametani. And they can give it back to you and you're allowed to accept it, even though you can't necessarily demand it in court. Again, this is Rav Yosef's explanation. Still, they can give you the money and you don't have to say anything about it. Which makes sense, you wouldn't have to say anything because the point is it's not Shemitah. How do we know that you have to say Mishametani? Kiditznan, as it says on the Mishnah, Machzir Cho B'Shvi'it, if someone's returning a loan on the Shemitah year, Yomarlo Mishametani, you have to say Mishametani. Vimamarlo, Afapichain Yikabel Mimenu. But if you say, well, if the person who you borrowed the money, who borrowed the money from you wants to give it back, he says, I know that really I don't have to pay you back, but I want to pay you back, then you can accept the money. How do you know that you have to say the words Mishametani? Mishum Shinemar Bezed Dvar Hashmita. Zed Dvar Hashmita, Dvar means from the Lashon of Dibor, speech. Means there has to be some wording going on. You have to say the words Mishametani. Rav Avya, Shakil Mashkona, Rav Bar'ula Marim Yarume. Okay, these people, as in order to avoid having to go to court, so one of them took a Mashkon, he took a collateral, and the other one would be Marim Yarume. What would he do? That means he would come to the guy's house after Yom Tov. On Yom Tov, he wouldn't take anything. Go to his house after Yom Tov and ask for something, take it, and then not give it back to him until he gave him back the money. It was a way of kind of a loophole around it. V'chein Erev Pesach. Now we're back to this Erev Pesach case where we said on Erev Pesach, the Mishnah had said that in Yerushalayim, Shechali Yopa Shabbat, if it turned out Erev Pesach was on Shabbat, you can leave your talit etzlov and otel epischo. You can go buy your meat from the butcher and leave him something of yours and then pay him back after the Chag is over, right? After Shabbat and after the Chag. So Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Makadish Adam Pischo B'Shabbat B'Chagigato B'Yom Tov. You can sanctify, you can basically take an animal and say, I'm designating this for a sacrifice on Shabbat. I'm sorry, your Korban Pesach on Shabbat, even if it's on Shabbat, and your Korban Chagiga, even if it's on Yom Tov. That was the special sacrifice they brought on Yom Tov. Neima Meseyale, why don't we say that this supports him? V'chein Erev Pesach B'Yerushalayim, Shechali Yopa Shabbat, Minech Talito Atzlov, V'Notel Pischo V'Oseim Achshbon Achar Yom Tov. Here you see, he purchases it basically on Erev, on Shabbat. That seems to indicate he must have also designated it as a sacrifice and sanctified it. So they say, no, not necessarily. Our mission doesn't prove, because hacha b'mayaskina b'memane acherim imo'al pischo. To make kara mikdish v'kai. It could be where what you were really doing was buying your share of the Korban Pesach from people that already had the animal and already had it sanctified. And then it wasn't like you're sanctifying it, you're just buying a share of something that was already sanctified. V'ha anantna, but doesn't it say in the Mishnah, ein nimnim ala be'ema b'tchila b'yom tov? You're not allowed to decide on Yom Tov you want to join someone else's sacrifice, and probably you can't do this on Shabbat either. So how can you do that? You can't join, buy your way in on Shabbat. So they say, shanehacha kevan deragil etzlo. This is great. This is right. If you have the same people for Seder every year, and let's say you didn't invite them necessarily, but they just assume that they're coming anyway. So here, if you have the same people every year on your Korban Pesach, and the guy didn't ask you beforehand, but basically when you sanctify that Korban, you must have had him in mind because you knew he was going to come be part of your Pesach, Korban Pesach. And therefore, again, where are we holding? That proves that the Korban Pesach, this situation of our mission does improve Rabbi Yochanan, because it could be it was already sanctified from before. The Hatane, but a further question. Doesn't Rabbi Yoshaya teach the following braita? Holech adam etzel ro'eh ha-ragil etzlo, v'noten lo tale l'pischo u'makdisho, v'yotzebo. You can go to the ro'eh that you normally go to on Shabbat. He can give you your lamb for the Korban Pesach, and you sanctify it. V'yotzebo, and you can then be yotze with that animal. So again, hatamnami kevan deragil etzlo akdusha le'mikara. The butcher knew, he knows you come every single year for the meat. So he realizes you didn't show up and it was going to be Shabbat. So before Shabbat, he sanctified it with you in mind, knowing that you were going to come by this piece of meat. Vaha makdish, right? So, but then it says, noten lo tole l'pischo u'makdisho. You can't say he didn't sanctify it. It says here he sanctified. So hamakdish katani. So what do they answer? Hekdish iloy midrabanan. That was like an extra sanctification that the rabbis added. It's more just saying, well, I'm sanctifying it also. But really, it must be that the butcher sanctified it from before, in which case we don't have proof for Rabbi Yochanan. Umiyamar Rabbi Yochanan hachi, because Rabbi Yochanan really has said this. Vahamar Rabbi Yochanan, alacha kistam mishnah. Same question we had the other day. Rabbi Yochanan says, alacha kistam mishnah. So how could he say like this? Vitnan, it says in the Mishnah. Lo makdishim, v'lo marichim, v'lo machrimim, v'lo magbihim trumot u'masrot. Kol elu b'yom tov, kavachomer b'shabbat. All these things you can't do on Yom Tov. You can't sanctify something. You can't do erchim, which is giving the value of something to the temple. You can't do a cherem, which is saying, I'm giving this value of an item to the temple. And you can't take trumot u'masrot out of your food. And you can't do that on Yom Tov, all the more so on Shabbat. So how could you possibly be sanctifying? So lo kashya kam b'chovot shekavu alehem zman. So again, what does Rabbi Yochanan say? Remember, Rabbi Yochanan said you can actually sanctify your Korban Pesach on Shabbat. This goes against the explicit Mishnah, and he always holds like a Stam Mishnah. So the answer is, there's when it said, lo makdishim, v'lo marichim, v'lo machrimim, those are all voluntary things, where they don't have a set time, like by saying, I'm going to bring a Korban Ola, a burnt offering to the Beit HaMikdash. But when it's something that has a set time, like the Korban Pesach, because you're going to miss your opportunity, we allow you to do it even on Shabbat. So we distinguish between things that can be sanctified on Shabbat versus other things that can't be sanctified on Shabbat. Okay, we'll stop here for today and pick up with the Mishnah on Sunday morning. Shabbat Shalom or Shavuot Tov.